And let's talk about Adam and Eve. When you were a Christian, how did you interpret the Adam and Eve story?
Well, as a Christian, it was I took it as literally. It was true. I believe that 6 to 7,000 years ago, that God created the world in 7 days. I believed that Adam and Eve were the first people on this earth, and so everything that you read throughout Genesis, the first, I mean, especially the first three chapters, but then the whole book, the whole Bible, I believed it literally. Believed that it was all exactly as it was written.
And now, what do you believe now, since you're not a Christian anymore?
You know, as you ask the question, in light of modern science, one of the things that led me away from Christianity was when I began to ask questions in light of modern science, just like your question asked, because then I began to see there were some concerns with the story, and one of them being that when you're dealing with Adam and Eve being only 6 or 7,000 years ago, science tells us that it's just not possible. There's too much genetic diversity among people today on this planet for us to have come from an original pair. And so that's one of my first big concerns. I mean, I figure if you're going to investigate something, start at the beginning. And so I did in Genesis, in the creation story, and in Adam and Eve. And you begin to see that it's a fantastic story. It's a great tale. But as being possible, you know, I know many people will run to, well, it's a miracle. Well, it would have to be, because scientifically, it's just Adam and Eve just aren't possible.
So was there a time, so now you totally accept evolution, that humans evolved from other animals?
I do, yes.
So how did that transition happen as a Christian? I mean, was that painful, or how did you do that?
Oh, no, everything that went from being a Christian to where I am today was painful, because I'm 40 years old, and this process began when I was, I would say, 35, and it took 2 to 3 years to admit to myself what I believe now, the transition from a believer to an unbeliever. Mm-hmm. And so now I'm 2 years, I would say, into certainty of what I believe now, but it's very, very painful, because it's a story that, it's not a story that is created for children, but it's a story that I grabbed onto as a child, and I've held onto it my whole life. And so, yes, it's very painful when you look back and think, you know, this is what I believe with all my heart. And as a former pastor, I didn't just believe it, but it was my career. It was my life. It was, you know, you. And so when you take things literally and then you begin to doubt the possibility of them, it's a very difficult process to go through, no doubt about that.
Well, do you remember, was there something you learned that, like, was there a day when you thought, okay, now I'm an evolutionist, or now I accept evolution? Was there something that triggered that, some things you've learned specifically?
I would say, other than just reading, I tried to avoid science. I know not all Christians are like that, and I'm thankful for that, but I was brought up to be careful with science and learning about dinosaurs and fossils and those things, because they could be contrary to what I believed, and so we avoided them. I grew up in the Bible Belt in the South, and a lot of things that I've since learned, I've had to learn on my own, and so to put it into an answer to your question, was that there's nothing specific I can think of that I learned, but it was just a process of learning. I began to realize that to be possible, evolution was the best choice.
Okay, did you go to a Bible college?
I did. I went to a 4-year what was called a Christian college, and I got a psychology degree, and I went back for my master's of ministry, and I think that's where my first concerns were, because I had all these questions and nobody wanted to answer them. Mm-hmm. And nobody wanted to discuss them.
And where did you get your master's in ministry degree from?
I started at it's called Freedom Bible College. And I can't tell you much more about it, because it's been over 20 years ago since I've been there.
Was it a Baptist, or what kind of denomination was it? affiliated with?
I don't remember. All I remember of it is I was able to do it online, and I was already in ministry at the time, and so it fit my schedule. And so, I liked the things they offered, and so I started to go there.
Yeah, I remember like the seminary I went to, for example, on Noah's Ark, our next section, they just assumed there was a worldwide flood, and they never even looked at the other alternatives. And they're like, "How would you defend this?" It was like, very narrow and just pushing a certain viewpoint. So when you were a pastor, did questions of evolution come up like some of your congregants would come to you and say, "What do you think of evolution?" And would you say like, "Oh yeah, it's all wrong," and would you point to people to like a ministry like Ken Ham's ministry or something like that?
Thankfully, nobody did. But yes, I would have if that's what they would have said to me. Like, what do you believe about evolution? I would have instantly said, well, it can't be true. It goes against what I believed at the time.
Yeah, it goes against the Bible.
Yeah, so I would have, of course, led them away and led them to something like Ken Ham and different groups like that, or different quote unquote scientists, I have to say. But I'm thankful that I didn't get that question, because I'm embarrassed about enough things that I taught in the past. That really would have been discouraging to think that I would have, you worry about leading people to something that's not true.
So while you were a pastor, the topic never really came up for you about Adam and Eve?
No, we had lots of children in the church, and nobody ever just came up. They may have asked our Sunday school teachers. But nobody ever asked me what I really thought or wanted to ask questions. And I wish they would have, because that's the time when I was having questions. I would love to have discussed it or had a reason to go. I mean, I had a good reason to look it up, but
But
I'd
when
like to have
you,
somebody kind of push me into it.
I can imagine though, when you preach, I mean, I hear preachers talk all the time. They may not say anything about evolution, but they say things like, well, that's not the way it was from the start in the garden with Adam. So, they believe in a literal Adam, even though they don't talk about evolution. Is that what, did you ever preach about Adam and Eve, or did you ever preach the gospel like, the sin started with the first man
Well,
kind of thing?
absolutely, because that's and
So.
that's one reason that so many preachers do that today, is because it is the it sets the stage for the fall of the human race, and then it makes the way for us to have a need for Jesus. And that's the problem with when you get into disagreeing with or showing anything that is a conflict to the Adam and Eve story. It starts at the very foundation of Christianity, and it's something like, wait a minute, you can't mess with that, because without that, we don't need this, and without this, and it goes down the
Right.
line to there's no need for anything if that's not
Yeah.
true.
Yeah, I mean the gospel, usually the gospel preachers, they start with you're a sinner and you need salvation, and why are you a sinner? It's because we inherited sin from Adam and Eve. And
Right.
so if you no longer believe that there was a first human, because with evolution, the way I put it is evolution falsifies the idea of a first human. Dawkins writes about this in his book, The Magic of Reality. He elaborates on this, but basically every species arises over time and within a population. So it's not at all like a first human popped out of a non-human, according to evolution. It has to happen within a population. There is no one characteristic that a human has that its parent did not have, kind of thing. So there was no first human. There's no first rabbit. There's no first whale. So that really strikes at. So it's interesting. A lot of Christian apologists will say, well, that's a side topic. We don't need to get into Adam and Eve. And it's like, really, it is at the core of the gospel, because they're trying to explain how sin came into the world.
True. And I think a problem going on today is you have a lot of Christian, well, not a lot, let me rephrase that. You have some Christians and groups that are denying the literary character of Adam and Eve, and that creates an issue for themselves, because if they deny that it's a literary, it actually happened, then they're going to begin to eventually deny the need for what they believe now. And so it's so important to it's a slippery slope for believers, no doubt. But
Yeah.
I think you got to look at it, and like even like the question is, in light of modern science, it's difficult to believe it. And I think
Right.
that's why it has to be on faith, because on fact you can't accept it.
Right, and those, and I found that those Christians who do say they accept evolution and also the gospel, they will say, "Well, sin came into the world somehow, but we don't know how." And as far as I'm concerned, they're just not facing the consequences. Sometimes they'll say, "Well, I know about science, I'm just not a theologian." It's like, come on, how do you really have to be a PhD with a theology degree in order to understand the basic gospel? You know, it's just that's just their way of trying to avoid it.
Yeah, and that makes no sense. If God really does love people so much as, you know, believers will tell you, then he's not going to make things so complicated. So saying that they are complicated is an excuse to avoid dealing with the doubts and the conflicts.
Okay, is there anything else you want to say on this topic before we move on to the next one?
No, I think we've covered it pretty well.
Okay, I mean, there's always more I could go on and on
Oh, yeah,
about it, but
absolutely. Yeah.
just want to make sure I didn't cut you off on any thoughts.
No,
Okay,
sir.